Call your dog off. Call your dog off. Call your dog off.
On October 13th, 2021, Officer Sierra Brooks confronted homeless veteran Joshua Rohrer for allegedly panhandling. Rohrer was accompanied by his service dog, Sunshine.
I just saw you take money from that car.
Yeah, you saw me take money, but you didn't see me ask for it.
All right, let me get your ID, okay?
You can't ask for my ID if
yes, I can.
Giving you money.
Okay, get your dog, okay? Yes, I can. It's called panhandling.
But it's not panhandling if I didn't ask for it, is it?
ID. You can give me your ID or you can go to jail for RDO. Which one you want to do?
What's the ID for that?
Because I'm about to write you a citation.
For what?
For panhandling.
That's not panhandling.
Yes, it is.
No, it's not. If you come up to me and give me money...
You walked out to the car.
Because they stopped. Did you see them
okay.
stop?
Give me your
you
ID.
You saw the whole situation.
Give me your ID or you're going to jail for RDO, which is resist, delay, obstruct. Okay.
You're going to write a disabled veteran that's living in the woods.
Asking for money and just being handed money are two different things that the officer failed to comprehend. Sad to see how veterans are treated in today's day and age.
Watch me walk up the sidewalk.
Sit back in Third City. I'm out with that subject.
Like, you literally watch me walk up the sidewalk.
Okay, give me your ID,
sir.
Give me your ID.
You're going to write me a ticket.
Yes.
I didn't commit a crime.
You violated a city
no,
ordinance.
No, I didn't. There's no city ordinance that says somebody can't give me money.
And you obstructed traffic.
No, I didn't. They did. They obstructed traffic and put the one in the car.
Give me your ID, sir.
I'm not giving you my ID.
Rohrer was in his rights to not give his ID. Of the 16.5 million veterans in the United States, there were an estimated 37,000 homeless veterans in 2020, with around 15,000 living completely unsheltered. And Officer Brooks decided to make this one's life way worse.
It's not going to go the way you want it to go.
I want to talk to a supervisor.
He's on his way out here. He's on his way out here.
Yeah, I saw him at the Circle K the other day with the car.
Yeah.
Yeah.
So now he's refusing to give me his ID because I'm going to write him a
violation. She's trying to write me a ticket because I was walking up this, packing up. She told me to pack up.
I told you.
And I was literally rolling the front row. And somebody stopped and gave me money. And you saw it yesterday. He saw it too. People give me money without me asking. I don't have
Because you're, first of all, I mean, it can be inferred, okay? Because that's the way the law works.
Right.
Things can be inferred. So if it appears that you're violating the ordinance, that's how that works.
Soon after Brooks called for backup, Officer Maurice Taylor arrived on scene. And he may be right about if a citizen breaks the law, but Joshua was doing nothing but minding his business. Cops had no evidence of panhandling.
How that works.
Right, but
let me tell you, because you're not a lawyer,
right.
You can get one, but I can tell you how the law works. You're in a median, right? You're waving at people in the median after I've told you.
Down like this.
Yes.
I sit there and observe you, and that lady is a witness down there.
Yeah, and I walked up here because I packed
up
like you told
me. I just want you to know, you can go to jail for this ordinance. If you continue to argue with officers, you're going to go to jail.
We are
going to call animal control for your dog. You got it? Okay.
But
you cannot be here.
That's fine.
He went so far as to threaten Rohrer with jail time and taking away his only friend in the world, his dog, to animal control, just for arguing with the officers. What kind of laws is this pig making up?
For what? You're waiting for a ticket for a crime I didn't commit.
Can we get your ID?
Dude, I didn't commit this crime.
But you're also in the median after I've told you not to be here before. Have I not said that?
And that's why I was vacating, because she asked me to leave. And I was literally walking up here. I didn't ask anybody for money.
Okay.
That's right. I'm taking this to trial.
You can.
That's fine. You can.
It's going to go to trial anyway. You don't even have to ask.
Oh, it's going to trial.
Oh, I know.
You're wasting taxpayer dollars.
Okay.
Well,
I pay my taxes too.
The officer was proud to announce that she pays taxes too, as if that seems to give her a free pass to subject this homeless man to this treatment.
There you go.
No, your state ID, not your VA
this
ID.
This isn't valid. It's not valid.
I need your state ID, not your VA ID. I'm going to ask you one more time.
It's
not even
valid.
Give me your state ID.
Date.
Turn around. You're being arrested.
Whoa, what for, dude?
Turn around.
Are you kidding me?
Turn around.
Do
turn
you
around.
See this?
Turn around.
Somebody help me.
Turn around.
Hey, what are you doing?
Turn around.
What are you doing?
Call your dog off. 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 Sir, call your dog off. Call your dog off. He just bit me. He bit me. Call your dog off. To Charlie. Call your dog off.
Sun City. We need more units. We need more units.
Help me! Stop! Why are you doing this? Somebody help me! Record!
Turn around.
Record this!
Turn around, sir.
What you witnessed just now was an extreme example of police brutality and animal cruelty. Not only did these ridiculous pigs of officers pin the veteran to the ground, they tased his service dog as well. It's obvious Sunshine, the dog, was wagging her tail and was so afraid it didn't even bark at the officers while they arrested its owner.
Turn, sir, turn around.
No!
Turn away.
Why are you doing this?
To Charlie 10 City, taser deployed on the dog.
Why are you doing this to me?
No taser, Charlie 10 was bit by the dog.
It bit my foot and I knew it was going to bite you, sir.
Charlie 10 was bit by the dog.
10-4, it didn't break my boot, but it bit my boot.
Help me!
Rohrer cried out for help, while the officers blatantly lied that his dog had bit them. According to a recent report, as many as 500,000 U.S. troops who were deployed in Iraq and Afghanistan over the past 13 years have been diagnosed with PTSD. So this trauma from cops was the last thing they needed.
Relax, and give me your hand.
Why are you doing this? I haven't done anything.
Sir, his dog bit me.
Help me record
his dog
this.
Bit me.
His dog is never taking.
I get you, but when we are out here trying to get something from him and it won't happen, I have to do what I have to do. The dog bit me, okay?
No, it didn't, because you shot him with a taser. Please help me. Why are y'all doing this to me?
They asked me for,
my ID, and then he grabbed me and tackled me.
Because you wouldn't give it to me.
Floor. I was in the process of handing it to you.
Bystanders knew Rohrer and soon came to the scene to defend him. The community knew he and his dog were harmless, but the officers were just adamant on lying.
Dog! They tased it. Please record this.
It's really sad how the dog bit you.
Please record this. Why are y'all doing this to me?
This guy's here all the time.
Dude, I get it, but it doesn't change the fact that the dog bit me. Okay? Can y'all just back up, please?
Did you see the dog bite his foot?
Dude, he tased my dog. Of course. Like, seriously, why are y'all doing this to me?
Okay, but we have to do our job. Did he see the dog bite?
I don't know what they do with Sunshine. Where's my dog? Sunshine Ray. I need my dog. She's my medical device. Where's my dog? Where's my dog? Where's my dog? Where's my dog? Where's my dog, man? What are y'all doing with my dog? Where's my dog?
Give me a second.
Rohrer was clearly spiraling out and was worried about nothing else but his dog, with not a care in the world for anything else in this traumatic moment.
But when we're trying to detain the owner, of course the dog's going to, and I asked him to call his dog off. The dog got on the hood of the car, and the dog began barking. The dog initially barked and bit my boot, but it didn't break my boot. I did not want this dog to bite my partner. You understand?
No, I understand.
Okay, we asked for his ID. He refused us to give us his ID.
Ma'am, I need your assistance. I need your help.
I'm not sure. She's mad because he's here all the time, and they don't like the fact that we had to do what we had to do.
He got on top of the hood and started barking. If I refresh your memory for a second.
Call your dog off. To Charlie. Call your dog off.
That was certainly not the case, and the officer really didn't feel any shame while lying.
But everybody's out. Everybody's out here.
Dude.
His dog initially bit me.
No, you chased my dog. My dog was running away and he shot her while she was running away.
I didn't shoot her. I tased her.
Yes, he did. He tased her for no reason.
My camera's still on.
My dog never hurt anybody.
So he was out here. We told him. I'm just going to give you a background on the whole story.
Right.
I came out here last week, right? He was in the median. I told him to remove from the median because he is begging for money. He says, I'm just waving. I'm not doing anything. I was like, okay, well, at least you have to get off the median, okay? You can't be in the median. He's like, basically, he's like, well, I can be on the sidewalk. He went over to the sidewalk. I let that be, okay? From people, getting money from people. You can articulate that as solicited money because he's standing in the median after I told him last week not to do the same thing.
Okay.
I guess he refused to give Brooks his ID. He refused to give Brooks his ID. So he gave us his VA ID, and I said, no, not your VA ID. I need your license, okay? I understand the VA ID doesn't have certain information on it. I'm also a veteran myself. I get it.
Yeah, yeah, yeah.
Okay? So he starts getting angry and whatnot. He's like, this one is not valid. This one is not valid. Take my VA ID. I was like, no, sir. I need your state ID that you have.
It's astounding to see how he has no issue with doing everything he did, despite being a veteran himself. He clearly has no remorse for his own, and that's as low as anyone can fall.
Because we're trying to identify him. So I go to put him in handcuffs. He starts resisting, saying help, help, screaming help. His dog starts looking worried and whatnot. He runs over to my foot, and he nips it like he nips at my foot. It doesn't nip, but he actually bites my boot, but it doesn't break my boot. At that point, I'm telling him to call off his dog. Okay, at that point, yeah, that's exactly where it was. I told him to call off his dog. The dog jumps up on the hood, and I'm thinking it's going to bite Brooks at this point as we're doing this, because the dog is obviously worried. It's going to try to protect his owner.
What's worrying is that this first account is the information that ultimately goes in the files for the charges. So this cop was essentially committing a lower form of perjury by lying through his teeth. This is what a corrupt cop looks like.
What? That's a logical thing to do. Instead of shooting the dog, you get what I'm saying? And so I can protect my partner, because I'm not about to let my partner get bit by a dog. It's a German Shepherd.
Ultimately, he tops off his story with some sort of reason to justify his actions and the mental trauma he put Rohrer through. In the end, Rohrer was arrested on charges of panhandling and resisting arrest during the incident. Sunshine survived the October 13th encounter with police, but died days later after being struck by a car. At the time, she was in the care of Rohrer's veteran advocate. Joshua bailed out of jail the next day and recounted his horrors in an interview.
They proceeded to attack me and rough me up and use excessive force and what I would consider police brutality.
Soon afterwards, all charges on Joshua were dropped, and he decided to sue the city and the police department.
I'm just at a loss for words right now. I really don't know what to say. They lied.
Rohrer's lawyers claimed his rights, from the First to the 14th Amendments, and including protections under the Americans with Disabilities Act, the Rehabilitation Act, and state law, were violated after he was arrested for simply standing on a median.
In honor of all veterans in front of the Gaston County Courthouse.
Eventually, the PD said Joshua Rohrer had reached an agreement with the Gaston County District Attorney's Office to resolve the case. The department characterized the agreement as beneficial to both Rohrer and Gastonia's residents. Officer Brooks and Officer Taylor were not charged for their crimes, but are till this date being publicly shamed wherever their patrol cars pass by. If the last case didn't show you how police can end up ruining their own careers, this next one really shows us the result of police brutality, corruption, and laziness.
They hit that wall so hard, I thought they were gonna come through the wall.
In the middle of the night on May 30th, 2021, two Idaho Springs police officers, Officer Nicholas Hanning and Officer Ellie Summers, banged on 75-year-old Michael Clark's apartment door. What happens next is one of the worst cases of corruption in the police.
This is Brittany.
That was the neighbor right there.
You're the one to call.
Wait.
This is Brittany. Okay. She's the one that got hit. I live here. This is my friend Brittany.
Yeah, they're there.
And then this is my neighbor that hit her. I wasn't even here. I was outside. She's on the phone to dispatch.
Which room?
Okay.
Which?
Okay.
This
all right. Thank
right
you.
Right here is what she said.
Okay.
Like I said, I wasn't in here. I literally
he
just saw.
He banged on the door, like, or through the wall. Bam, bam, bam. And I'm sleeping. Shut the. And so I like came out and was like, what's going on?
What's concerning with this woman's story is how she's slurring every word and is extremely drunk. Amazing how the officers don't pick up on this at all.
Right to the fucking mouth.
Okay.
Which room is
he in? I don't know. Right there, possibly.
Okay.
What does he look like?
He is an older man. I honestly don't know. When you get knocked off, you don't really.
We just moved into this.
Okay. When did this happen?
20 minutes, 15. I called.
Not even.
Not even. I called, I walked in the door and...
He blew my nose, my mouth.
The cops, obviously negligent of some obvious holes in Brittany's story, ignoring the fact that there was not a drop of blood on her or around her. Adding to this problem, there were also no witnesses to what she alleges.
All I wanted to do was hey, what was disturbing you? And he was like, shut the fuck up, boom!
Was he white, black, Hispanic?
He's white.
Does he have hair?
Yeah.
Is he bald?
Gray hair?
Yeah, gray hair. He's an older guy, he's about this tall. That, and that guy lives right there in that room. And that's where the wall would be up.
He was seen him bang, before. Bang, bang. That's what woke me up.
The cops, having heard enough, proceed to ignore the facts and move on to Clark's apartment. Our victim, Michael Clark, can be seen answering the door worriedly. So much so, he's armed with a small knife. However, even after disarming, the cops seem disinterested in anything he has to say.
What the
unconscious.
It was obvious that the cops had already made up their mind, and Clark getting tased was inevitable.
Shit. 207 taser deployed. Party came out with a machete.
After cuffing Clark up, if this wasn't cynical enough, the officer removed the weapon from Clark's cupboard and placed it out in the hallway. He does this in order to further incriminate this poor old man, showing their blatant corruption.
I got him.
He's breathing, he's fine.
Okay, stay on your side, stay on your side. Stay on your side. I'm police, I'm the police. Stay on your side.
He hit my wife.
I understand.
I hit my wife's word.
I understand, sir.
I.
Stay on your side. Stay on your side.
I heard a loud bang there. Heard a big bang on the wall. And, it nearly moved my bed nearly a couple of feet. And then, I pound on the wall.
Okay.
I told him, knock it off. And I was doing nothing.
Even after Clark regains consciousness, the police only seem to be concerned with questioning him immediately.
What's that?
They hit that wall of mine there. I thought they were coming through it.
Okay, all right. All right, here's, what's your name? What's your first name?
Mike.
Mike? Okay. You're under arrest right now, okay? So you have the right to remain silent. Anything you say can and will be used against you in a court of law.
I was in there. They hit that wall so hard that I nearly got bounced out of bed. That wall, I mean, it's like...
How much have you had to drink?
None.
None?
None.
You've had nothing to drink?
Nothing to drink. You can test me if you want. I'll submit to a test. But these people here, they're the ones that rattled my walls.
After the officer places Clark under arrest, he's not happy to learn that Clark had in fact had nothing to drink. This only ruined their plans to get him to criminalize himself.
What do I do?
What's that?
What did I do?
You punched that girl.
Huh?
Punched that girl and then answered the door with a freaking machete, man.
That is absolutely false.
All right.
Okay.
We're going to stand you up. We're going to sit you on the pram. Since you were out, since you're unconscious, we're going to take you down to the ambulance and evaluate you. Okay?
I did not come after nobody.
Okay. You're dealing with me now. We're going to go down to the...
Even now, the cops are unresponsive to Clark's explanation of the whole incident. The EMTs on site are unhelpful, as well as they keep interrupting him.
I did nothing.
I'm here for you because you're injured. I don't care what happens behind you.
Where am I injured?
You've got a big gash on your head. Plus, when they tased you because you came outside with that knife, you lost consciousness. You went unconscious. So I
what knife?
That big bat that he's holding. That looks like a freaking...
Where did you find that? Did you have to hunt for it?
It was laying right there on the ground when I walked in.
All right. I did not get that down.
Not arguing with you.
I did not get that down.
I'm going to go down with you.
You
want him out of cuffs up here?
Okay. Did you go in my apartment and look for weapons?
Mr. Clark, you're going to sit up straight.
Did you look in my apartment and look for weapons?
They don't need to look at in the apartment. It was here in the hallway.
How did you get in the hallway?
This is what it's like when evil, corrupt cops extend their powers and fake a scene in order to benefit them and their story. This is how they end up framing innocent men. Eventually, they put him in the restrained stretcher and took him away. As if this aggravated assault was the last of the police's worries for that day. If the officers had chosen to run a background check on Brittany, instead of harming an innocent old man, they would have discovered an array of crimes. Clear Creek District Court Judge Cynthia Jones ruled Thursday that Hanning will serve 2 years of supervised probation and complete 150 hours of community service for assaulting Clark. Jones said Hanning's actions were an abuse on the public trust by a police officer and a violation of his training, but that she also had to consider the low likelihood he would reoffend. She also said she did not want to sentence him to jail because it would cost the county's taxpayers. Brittany had been charged with attempted murder, fraud, lying to the police, and felony aggravated domestic assault. The police cripple a loving grandfather for the rest of his life due to the trauma and subsequent stroke he suffered from that night's attacks. If the last group of cops had you wondering about the extent of their evil, then this next one's for you, as they break all barriers to hell.
About your 10 followers or whatever you have on your line, but you don't have any business in my conversation.
You're a tyrant, sir.
On April 30th, 2023, the well-known YouTuber Long Island Audit named Sean was performing one of his routine audits at a Motor Vehicle Commission building, trying to simply exercise his First Amendment rights.
You can't record on the... You're recording.
Yeah.
You cannot record. There's a sign right here.
Yeah, I saw the sign.
Turn it off, please.
Who are you?
I'm the supervisor. Turn it off, please.
Supervisor for what? For the motor vehicle?
Turn it off. I'm going to get security and the police.
You can get whoever you want, ma'am.
You can't be on the phone over here.
Who are you?
I'm an officer.
Officer
what? And I
what?
Work here. Officer Gonzalez.
Yeah.
And you're not allowed to be
Officer
on the
Gonzalez,
phone.
Officer Gonzalez, I could use a little less of that attitude
but
you got there.
She's telling you to stop.
You're acting
you
a little
respect.
Bit extra. Yeah, I...
Respect what she's telling you.
Okay.
Do you how does come that, here? Are you going to take a test?
How does respect equate into what I'm doing?
Because she's telling you to turn the phone off.
All right. So think about your logic here, Officer Gonzalez. I could tell you, respectfully, I don't.
You want me to call Broadway police then?
You can call whoever you'd like, yeah. I don't have to listen to them either. No, the police are not going to come and get me. I don't have to listen to them either, ma'am.
Almost immediately, the auditor is bombarded with security, and the supervisor is trying to get him to stop recording. It doesn't take them long before they start throwing around threats of calling the police. Thankfully, Sean doesn't seem to care for that, and heads towards the police face first.
How you doing, sir?
What's going on?
Hey, how are you? Good. Good.
What's
happening? Nothing, just taking some pictures and video, and Officer Gonzalez and some other people seem to not like that a lot, so...
I'll tell them it's against the policy of the motor vehicle.
Well, this is private property, sir.
This is not private property.
This is private property.
This is not private property.
Yes, it is private property.
It's not private property.
It is private.
I looked up the surveys before I came here, and this is not private property. No, the state. This is owned by the state of New Jersey, which means that it's
property. Which is private property.
You're saying that the state
motor vehicle is part of this private property.
No, it's owned by the state, which means that it's public property, sir.
Sean is correct here, as state-owned property is technically purchased by taxpayer dollars ultimately, and can be therefore inferred as public property. But these officers disagree.
So who's it owned by?
It's the owned state. By the state, yes.
Okay. But so
so you saying any place in the state you could go there?
Yeah.
Go there?
Any state any state property that's not restricted? Yeah, I can go
well,
there.
She's saying it's against their policy for anybody to be.
Hi, how are you, ma'am?
Good, how are you?
Doing good. Can I get your name and badge number, please?
Sure, I'm Officer Maloney. Can you take your hands out of your pockets for my safety?
Oh, my hand in my pocket's not again, not for your safety.
Yes, it is. It's for my safety, sir. Can
it's you take a little chilly out here. I don't have any weapons on me.
Sir, can you check them? Because I don't know what.
You cannot just check me. You can't do that. You can't go in my pockets. I don't consent to searches or seizures. Hey.
Sir, take your hands out of your pockets.
You can't tell me to take my hands out of my pocket. What? It's not against the law to keep my hand in my pocket. It's cold out here. It's a little windy out here.
I don't know if you have a weapon.
I don't. I'm telling you I don't. I'm not going to show you my hands, ma'am, because it doesn't. That's not against the law.
Another officer arrives on scene and immediately tries to violate the auditor's Fourth Amendment rights. Clearly, they're just chucking these officers out of the academies into the field with no training.
Hey, Sergeant. How are you, Sarge? Hey, Sarge. If I can speak to you for a minute.
Sure.
Thank you.
He won't take his hands out of his pocket.
Well, that you got to do for my safety and if
sir,
you want to speak to me, take your hand out of your pocket so I know I'm safe in your state.
But sir, you have five officers here.
That doesn't matter. I've done this for a long time. They're asking you to take.
But you can see that I don't have any weapon.
I can't.
Yes, you can.
No, I can't.
Yes, you can.
No,
does that look like? Does that look?
Just show me your hand then.
But no. But it's a power thing.
I'm not going to entertain that.
It's a power thing. It's a power thing.
I'm asking to see your hands the way you can.
And you can see what's in my pocket.
No, I can't.
You can.
I'm not asking to see what's in your pocket. I'm asking to see your hand.
So if I took my hand out of my pocket and then I put my hand back in my pocket.
If you want to put it back in your pocket,
that makes no sense.
Outside of your pocket to make sure there's nothing in there. So do you want to take your hand out of your pocket or would you like me to pat?
I would like.
At first, Sean was glad to see a supervisor, but this quickly fades too, as he is fairly demanding of the officer and just trying to throw his power around.
Everybody's safe. What is wrong with you? Everybody
there isn't
is safe.
Wrong with me. You asked to talk to me.
Yeah, and
so
I'm
now I'm here to
and
talk
I'm here to
you.
Complain. Excuse me, let me speak, please.
Complain. I'm, not
I'm here.
Gonna,
I'm here
I'm
to
not
issue a complaint.
I see your hand out of your pocket.
I'm here to issue
I'm
a complaint
not
for the same
until
exact
you
thing.
Your hand out of your pocket.
Let me speak to your
no,
supervisor.
No, I am my supervisor.
No, you're
I'm
not.
The road supervisor.
No, you're not. There's
are.
A lieutenant above you.
No, he's on the desk. He's not on the road. So if you want to go inside, we can go speak to him.
You are giving off a horrible example for your police
I'm
department.
Not giving a hor-
because
I'm
my hand
to
is in my pocket.
Hand out here so I know everybody's safe. I don't know
everyone
you,
is
you don't
safe.
Know me.
I don't know you, but yeah, you have a gun. He has a gun.
Well,
he has a weapon.
To do with it. Okay. My hand's not near my gun. So all I'm asking
it doesn't
you to
matter.
Take so I can
I don't have
to
a
you.
Weapon. It doesn't matter.
Well,
so you should be able
that.
To call people. You should be able to talk to people
I'm trying
that have
to talk
their
to
hand
you.
In their pocket.
Well, no, that's not. And once, if you want me to pat it, and then I can be sure there's nothing
no,
in your pocket.
No, I don't
pocket.
Consent.
It's amazing to see that a police sergeant surrounded by half of his precinct is afraid of a man filming with his hand in his pocket. The police have really become scared children at this point.
138.
Sergeant Dayon, my name is Sean. I'm an independent journalist. I'm working on a story here at the Motor Vehicle Commission.
For what? Do you have their permission to be here? Did you
I don't need
to their supervisor?
I don't need their permission to be here. This is public property.
It's not public property in that sense.
It is public property.
It's public property if you're here to conduct business.
No, it's
if
public.
If not, they can tell people they don't want to service them or they can't be on
no,
the property.
No, they can't do that.
Yes, they can.
They can't do that.
Yes,
you're wrong.
Can.
I've spoken to the Motor Vehicle
well,
Commission.
Well, we're going to go speak to their supervisor since they're on their way. We'll find out. If they don't want you on the property, you can go film from off their property.
Ma'am, you got out of your car and try to act super aggressive. I don't know if you're overcompensating
because
you're.
Because
I don't know what you're
your
doing.
Actions.
No, they're not.
That's
no one's scared.
I didn't come here.
No
to
one's scared of my actions.
You came here to harass
no one
the
is.
Police,
no
sir.
One's scared of my actions. You're here to protect and serve the public, correct?
Yeah, I'm serving and protecting them from you.
From me, from
because
a camera.
They were afraid of you,
ma'am. You're afraid of me. Are you afraid
the
of me, ma'am?
Was afraid of you.
You're afraid of me.
That's what
oh
we
wow.
Mean, sir. I didn't come here on my own merit.
Yeah.
I came here because we were called here.
You came
the
here.
Public is scared.
Okay, that's fair enough.
Of you.
You. No one's scared of me.
Okay.
Ma'am, you came here for a call, right? I'm here exercising a constitutionally protected
okay,
activity.
That's, fine.
That's your
but,
job to uphold that.
Not, but it's not
that's
your
job
to
uphold that. I'm not harassing you.
The lady officer from before, who didn't waste any time in trying to violate his rights, is now trying to yap and make her case. Unfortunately for her, the auditor breaks her argument down.
I think your logic is flawed. You came up to me and said, get your hand out of your pocket. The video will speak for itself. The video will speak for itself. You came up to me and said, get your hand out of your pocket. I didn't say, sir. Ma'am, take that gun off your holster, did I?
Okay, sir.
For my safety, take that gun off your holster immediately, right? I didn't say that. Because that would be what? Escalating. Okay, and we need to de-escalate the situation, not escalate it.
At this point, the sergeant returns after speaking with the Motor Vehicle Commission's supervisor.
Can you do me a favor? I'm over here talking to my partner.
I understand.
You can't interrupt my conversation.
I don't want to interrupt your conversation.
Step away from me. You want to film over there? Film me. But don't get any closer to me. I'm speaking to my partner. It has nothing to do with you right now.
Everything that
it
you're
has
talking
nothing
about.
To do with you
everything
right now,
that
Sean,
you're talking about in public is my
not
business.
Get closer to me. Thank you.
Everything that you're talking about is my business,
don't
sir.
Get closer to me.
Sir, this is public property, like I told you before. If you want to have a private conversation,
I'm
I suggest you go in private and have that conversation, sir.
Sean, I don't know about your 10 followers or whatever you have on your line, but. You don't have any business in my conversation.
You're a tyrant, sir. And like I said, if you have a conversation you would like to have.
Your tens and tens of followers.
My tens and tens of followers.
If the sergeant hadn't already thrown around his weight enough in this video, he can't seem to stop. This time, not even letting the auditor record the police, which is entirely legal.
Way to represent Rahway Police Department. Way to represent. The people will see it, and they're going to hold you accountable. Yeah. My tens, you're not going to be that famous. I only have tens of followers. According to the sergeant. Take care, sergeant. You'll be hearing from me soon. We're definitely filing a formal complaint against this sergeant and this officer here.
Ultimately, the horde of police gathered there had to leave. This obviously since the auditor was performing a constitutionally protected activity, which supersedes any local rules or regulations. That's why ultimately the sign that doesn't allow citizens to film is inherently unconstitutional. The cops and civil servants were both unaware of this, and were just throwing their weight around despite being wrong. This shows the abysmal state of America's police force, and what would possibly become of it in the near future. Let me know in the comments below, and be sure to leave a like, subscribe, and share this video if you haven't already, and be sure to stay tuned for the next installment. This is Detective Mystery, signing off.